Welcome to We're on the Pier, and guess who's here? With me, Yael Breuer. Now, gay sex, straight sex, Brighton has it all. Let's find out. Well, if you're interested in lesbian input into straight sex, I've got the right person here. Ali H, a performer, presenter, founder of things. Let's hear about that. You've recently been on a Channel 5 show.
Yep, that's right.
Tell me a little bit about that.
Sure. So it's called The Lesbian Guide to Straight Sex. There are four of us, and we all have different skills and talents, and we advise straight couples on how they can improve their sex lives. So in the series, the first episode that's out now, that was two couples, and they came to us. They were having sex, but they just wanted to improve the quality of their sex. So, you know, we were kind of talking to them, finding out what was going on for them. A lot of it was about communication, but also some of it was about us giving them sort of tips and tricks on things they could
right.
try.
Which made me feel, I mean, obviously that's a little bit of showbiz, it's a television
yeah.
programme, but is there real significant value, do you think, in people who are straight seeking advice from people who are gay in order to enhance their sex life?
I think the starting point was the four of us who are the kind of coaches. We're all really comfortable talking about sex and intimacy and relationships. So when you've got that kind of arena to have those kind of discussions, you know, that helps, because quite often couples get into a rut and they might say what they fantasize about at the beginning of their relationships, but after 2 or 3 years you kind of get into a pattern and then you almost forget to explore,
right.
You know, to be adventurous. And so it came from that kind of starting point. Interestingly, when I was talking to people about going on the show, the first thing people said was, oh, so what have you told the guys?
Right.
And we were like, well, it's the couples, it's actually the guys and the girls, you know, it's talking about them both asking for what they want, them both kind of enjoying each other, talking about their own fantasies, being free to kind of try different things. So we took one of the couples, we took to a sex shop, and they had a lot of fun, and just making it fun and relaxed and not, you know, tense in any way.
And interestingly, one of the lessons learnt, and perhaps not surprisingly, is ultimately it's about how we feel about ourselves, and it doesn't matter at all if we're gay or if we're straight, or you know, how we feel about ourselves, and that would project onto our relationship and our sex life as well. And that's something that you've come across
yeah.
throughout filming the program, is that right?
Yeah, very much so. I think humans are put on this planet to connect. I think it is all about connection.
And talking about helping people,
yeah.
you do other things that are not unrelated. Here in Brighton, you run, for example, workshops for women only.
Yeah.
Tell me a bit about that.
Yeah. So I started the Short and Girly Show in 1999.
Which is such a good name.
Long time ago. Thank you very much. And we do Whose Line Is It Anyway shows. And we also produce 10-week and 6-week intensive workshops for women.
Nice.
And we do that down here. They are at the Marlborough Theatre. So we do them on a Monday night, and you sign up for either a 10-week or a 6-week course.
And yeah. talking about stand-up, you do that as well?
Yes, yeah, I do. So I turned 50 at the beginning of the year, and I was looking for a new challenge. And I've always done performance, so I do a drag queen character, I do a drag king character. And I'd sort of skirted around the edge of stand-up. Love watching it, always been involved. Short and Girly Show, we're always on a lineup with stand-up, so really into you know, that kind of medium, if you like. And I decided to give it a go at the beginning of the year.
And your show is funny, but it's also quite poignant, and you
yeah.
refer to some things that are perhaps not that easy, but out of choice, I suppose, in your
yeah.
own life. You talk about polyamory.
Yeah, so I one of the things that kind of drives me is entertainment, but also education through entertainment. And I'm very open about talking about my complicated love life in some instances, in terms of non-monogamy, so having more than one partner at the same time, having casual partners, believing that individuals can be in love with more than one person at the same time and have different kind of relationship setups, and just really being open to, you know, different ways of being in sort of loving relationships.
So if people wanted to find out about what you do, what
yeah.
you offer, even come and see you, how do they find out?
Okay, so if they're interested in the workshops or the Short and Girly Show shows, shows, then it is the Short and Girly Show Facebook page. If they're interested in finding out more about the stand-up and some of the other presenting stuff that I'm involved in, then again, it's Facebook and it's Ali H Comedy.
Lovely. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Lovely to see you.
If you're ever interested in finding out about the link between vocal music and the neuroscience of love, look no further. I have here in the studio Kate Daisy Grant, who is a musician, and Peter Eyres, who is a visual artist. Welcome, you two.
Thank you so much. Yael.
So you've come to tell me about your new album, Kate, Lullaby.
Yeah.
And about how the link between neuroscience of love and vocal music are portrayed here. Tell me a little bit about it.
Yes, so while I was, I'm a musician already with my husband Nick Pinn, and while I was training to be a somatic therapist, this particular part of neuroscience kept coming out, which is called polyvagal theory, which means that the fight, flight and freeze system that we use under stress or excitement can be affected by how we use our facial muscles, throat muscles included, and the neck turning muscles. And this can actually help us to, if we engage those muscles, to interact better with the world around us.
And we would use these muscles while listening to particular type of music or particular type of vocal?
So you don't have to be listening to music, but you can listen to particular frequencies of the female voice, which are normally found in lullabies. So this helps the middle ear muscles to attune to a frequency which makes us feel safe.
Right. And you're having a concert as well, so it's not just the album that's out, but people will be able to physically experience what you've just described, right? Do you want to tell me a little bit about the concert?
We thought it'd be very nice, Nick Pinn and I, Nick made the album with me, if we could make it a more immersive experience where you're not only surrounded and cocooned by these female voices coming from everywhere around, but that you're also being given images all around you as well, that you can be enhancing your felt sense of safety.
Okay, so before we talk about images, shall we just have a little taste of what the album is about?
Sure.
Wow, so that is a kind of all-inclusive experience, Peter. Tell me, as a visual artist, what exactly is happening there?
The album is made up of lullabies from over 100 countries. I think there are over 120 lullabies in there. And so, reflecting that, I've taken imagery sort of from the natural environment, scientific imagery, video and photography, and layered them to mimic the layering of the lullabies in the album. And then I'm using the album, the audio from the album, to animate that.
And people who will come to the gig will be able to kind of lounge and listen to the music and see the visual aspect of it, and the visual aspect of it will be kind of influenced by the vocal. Is that right?
Exactly. So there'll be visuals on the wall as well as on the ceiling.
And what I particularly liked is you actually produced a kind of schematic map, if you like, of the different countries that the lullabies came from. Did you find some common elements?
Yes, this was the idea of the album originally, is not only using the polyvagal theory to sort of enhance safety, but when I was looking at folk lullabies from around the world, how similar they actually were and what kind of tunes and little motifs were in so many of them from really disparate countries. And so I just began to layer them harmonically with each other. So sometimes on the album you've got about 16 lullabies playing with each other.
Oh, wow.
So some are being the background vocals and some are more at the forefront, but they kind of swim to the front and then they go to the side as another two or three come to the front. So, yeah, the map that you have there is on my website, katedaisygrant.com, as you listen to the album, or it comes with the CDs, which are available through Bandcamp. And, yeah, people can just see what minute they're on and where
in left or right, which countries are actually playing.
Wow, so enjoying music and having some kind of therapy in a way as well.
Hopefully.
Great. So, very quickly, what are the details of the gig at the Old Market? How do people find out about it?
Yeah, so it's the 7th of November at theoldmarket.com. So if people want to go onto that website, or they can go onto my website, katedaisygrant.com, and there's a link there on the live page. Yeah, and just bring something soft to lie on.
Sounds fantastic. Thank you so much, you two.
Thanks so much, Yael.
And that's the end of the first half. Join me after the break and we'll find out about a special music festival. Welcome back to We're on the Pier, and guess who's here? Now, it's never too early to listen to music in Brighton. Let's find out. Brighton Early Music Festival showcases music that is, well, very early, and its artistic director, Deborah Roberts, is here. Welcome, Deborah.
Hello.
So, about 1,000 years music? Is that old music? Is that right?
Yes, I think a lot of people, when they think of classical music, they're only really thinking about the last 150 years or so, when there is lots of concerts going on. But before that, music goes right back to the earliest times of humanity. But we're dealing with music in this festival from about the 11th century onwards.
Wow, that's impressive. Yeah. And there are 27 or so events in this festival.
Yes, there are.
Of all types.
Every possible type. If you think about how much music will have got composed over all those years.
Sure.
Yeah.
So we obviously can't do justice to the variety, but shall we just listen to one snippet of a taste? Tell me, what are we going to listen to?
Well, I think you're going to hear something from the Art of Moog, which is Bach, J.S. Bach, played on synthesizers.
Which is not something that naturally comes to mind.
No, but there again, our theme is metamorphosis, which is transformation, and Bach is so transformable.
Okay, so let's listen to that. That's really unusual and fantastic.
Well, I saw it live in London. When I first heard it, I thought, oh my goodness, I've never heard Bach so clear.
Right.
And all the lines, it was so powerful. I thought, we've got to get these guys to the festival.
What other highlights are there in this year's festival?
Well, another one which, again, is another thing which is really close to the theme of metamorphosis, is the 11th, 12th century mystic composer Hildegard of Bingen, and we've got that combined with a light show from Inner Strings with Chris Tomsett.
Oh, wow.
Because she used to get these visions, which were probably brought on by migraine. So we've got music from...
We don't know that, we just suspect that by nature.
It's being worked out
right.
because of the way that she painted as well.
Right.
So we've got a trio, a fabulous trio of young female voices singing some of the music, but also some 21st century compositions based on it.
Wow.
Plus the lights.
And it really sounds like a great fun community feast.
Oh, well, the very final concert on the 10th of November is going to be a 21st century take on the medieval Feast of Fools, which is when society was reversed for a day and the young put in charge. Well, we're thinking...
And that really happened?
It really happened. It went on for about 500 years. There were plenty of really rather naughty things going on, which
right.
got it banned in the end. But overall, it was a lovely idea. They had a child bishop who preached a sermon. So we're letting the kids take over in this show as well. There are going to be some great surprises. We've got the fantastic dancers from we've got the fantastic dancers from Street Funk coming in, dancing to medieval melodies.
Again, another interesting combination.
Yes, absolutely. And we've got loads of kids taking part, and there just might be a climate strike.
which actually brings me to the point that yeah. you mentioned earlier. This is all, you know, a lot of it is about historical music, etc., but very relevant to today.
It's totally relevant for today. People were always people. They had emotions, they had things they cared about. And I think that's really what we are trying to do with this festival. Don't perform museum pieces,
right.
but bring it up to date, not by changing the music necessarily, but by trying to capture what the mood was at the time and then recreate that in modern times.
Right.
So we really felt that the equivalent now of putting the young choristers in charge would be to say, well, let the school kids teach us a thing or two. And why not? It's happening a lot at the moment.
Absolutely.
With the school strikes.
Why not? So yeah. how do people find out about the festival?
Well, they can go to a website. In fact, if you just Google Brighton Early Music Festival, the actual web address is bremf.org.uk. But the great thing is that if you can go to What's On, if you click on What's On, and there's an event grid, but for every event, it's got its own page you can click on for more information. There are film clips and bits of music. So if you don't know what on earth this music is, go and find out.
Find out.
Yeah.
Deborah, thank you so much for coming.
You're welcome.
The Moulin Rouge, Las Vegas, the Palladium in London on a Sunday night. Nah, you don't need any of these when you can go to a burlesque and cabaret show in Brighton. And I have here promoter Giles Dexter and singer George Martin Marino to talk about this event. Hello, you two.
Hello.
Giles, good afternoon. Yeah.
Good
Great
afternoon.
To be with you.
Let's start with you, Giles. Tell me a little bit about this event that you're promoting.
Well, we're bringing back traditional seaside variety with a 21st century twist. So we've got magic, live show band, burlesque, contortionist, comedians, and basically the best night out in Brighton. And given that Brighton's the best city in Britain, then it's the best night out in Britain.
And you're going to be presenting, you're the compere, right?
No, my colleague Basil Valentine is the compere.
Right.
He's a rather reclusive, mysterious fellow. He's about 568 years old.
Is he really?
Yes, one of the last people to have made gold. And he spends most of his time in a cave, he's a hermit. But we roust him along, you know, once in a while for these shows, and he comes along and cracks a few jokes.
Right, OK. That sounds very exciting. Tell me more about the exciting things that will be on the night. What are the highlights?
Well, George is one highlight. Britain's answer to Julio Iglesias.
I can see that. A young Julio Iglesias.
Yeah, we've got two fantastic burlesque girls doing two spots each. Actually, three burlesque girls doing two spots each. We've got a brilliant escapologist, like Harry Houdini, and another magician who swallows a load of office furniture and regurgitates it on stage. So I believe. Anyway, we'll have to find out.
See. So. And it's at the Brunswick?
It's at the Brunswick, which is in Hove, actually.
Right. OK. And George, you're a singer, a bit of a crooner. What are you going to do on the night?
So on the night, I'll be singing with a band that I used to sing with a couple of years ago, the Fabulous Brighton Subs. And we'll be singing a couple of, we'll be doing a couple of like old jazz tracks, probably some Frank Sinatra will be in there. And we're also going to be doing a very special first glance at some of the original music that I've been working on with Giles as well, which
right.
will be quite exciting.
Right.
A new ballad for the ages, the 21st century my way.
Right. Sounds very exciting. And you perform anyway in quite a few venues, etc. Yeah.
Yeah. So I perform in venues like Bar Broadway, the new venue in Kemp Town, the Village, and also at the Regency Tavern as well. So I've been doing a lot of cabaret work in those bars the past year or so. Singing around Brighton. It's been quite
fun.
Wow, yeah.
Sounds very exciting. How can people find out about it?
Facebook, search Basil Valentine's Alchemical Circus, www.alchemicalcircus.com, and there'll be flyers and posters all over town.
Sounds fantastic. Thank you so much, you two, for coming.
Thursday, the 21st of November, at the Brunswick. See you there.
And that's it for tonight's show. Don't forget to join me every night at 8:30. Good night.